In this lecture, we will see the types of band gap in semiconductors. So first, let me write a simple definition of band gap. We know that the energy regions for which no electronic energy states exist is known as band gap, or sometimes we can say it as energy gap. If we draw valence band and conduction band of a semiconductor, at temperature T equal to 0 Kelvin, and we know that at this temperature all the states of valence bands are filled by the electrons. So this is valence band and this is conduction band. At 0 degree or 0 Kelvin temperature, all the energy states of valence band are completely filled, whereas all the energy states in a conduction band are completely empty. And here we are talking about this energy, where no electronic energy states are available for electron, and this gap is known as band gap. And we also know that this is the minimum of the conduction band and this is the top of the valence band or maximum of the conduction band. So in other words, we can say that the band gap is the minimum energy difference between valence band and conduction band. In semiconductors, there are two types of band gaps. First one is direct band gap, and second one is indirect band gap. So what is direct band gap? In direct band gap semiconductor, valence band and bottom of the conduction band occur at the same value of momentum, mostly at k equal to 0. But in indirect band gap semiconductor, the top of the valence band occurs at a different value of momentum to the bottom of the conduction band Dutch. In these two images, we can see that for a direct band gap semiconductor, the top of the valence band or maximum of the valence band and minimum of the conduction band occur at the same value of k. Most of the time, it is at k equal to 0. But in indirect band gap semiconductors, the top of the valence band occurs at a different value of momentum as compared to the minimum of the conduction band occurs. So we can see here valence band occurs at k equal to 0, but minimum of the conduction band occurs at a different value of k. Let's say it's at k1. So this is the difference between direct band gap semiconductor and indirect band gap semiconductor. So now let us discuss or understand these band gaps in details using some real examples. So first, let us take an example of gallium arsenide, and it has a direct band gap. This is the diagram of valence band of gallium arsenide. Here, this is on this axis, it's K and it's E. Before going deep in this band gap, first let me clear some big points. So please note these following points. First, that in you can see here, instead of writing as plus value of k, here k equal to 0, here I'm writing some symbols of the direction. So here I have written 100 direction, and here I have written 111 direction. So first we have to understand this convention. So in place of the usual positive and negative k axis, two different crystal directions are shown on the, I'm writing it as a x-axis, on the, let's say, x-axis. Okay, normally we from here we write plus x value, and in this direction we write minus x value. Or if I'm writing it, I'm taking this axis as a, or this scale as a k. So in usually we write plus k value in this direction and minus k value in this direction. So here I am not using that usual method. In most of the books you can see this type of EK diagram. So due to crystal symmetry, no new information is obtained by displaying the both negative and positive axes of k at the same time. Meaning is that due to crystal symmetry, anything happening in plus k direction should be happened in minus k direction. So if we plot this scale and when we draw some EK diagram, same diagram will repeat here. So we cannot get any new information by drawing EK diagram in this way. So by convention, 100 direction is plotted along the normal positive k axis and the direction (1, 1, 1) is plotted along the normal minus k axis. And I'm sure you know that this symbol is used for direction, and if we use some plane then we have to use this type of symbol. These symbols are used from middle indices. So here important thing is that why we use this direction and this direction only. So if we consider our semiconductor crystal structures, we know that most of the semiconductors are found in diamond or zinc blend structures, and in the case of diamond and zinc blend, crystal structures, the minimum, or if you add maximum, the maximum of valence band and minimum of the conduction band occur at k equal to 0 or along one of these directions. So why you are using these two directions, that is 100 or 111? Because in diamond or zinc blend structures, the minimum of the conduction band or maximum of the valence band occur at k equal to 0 or along one of this direction. Therefore we are plotting these directions in EK diagram. And we can see in this diagram that मैक्सिमम ऑफ द वैलेंस बैंड, हियर वी कैन सी मैक्सिमम ऑफ द वैलेंस बैंड एंड मिनिमम ऑफ द कंडक्शन बैंड अकर एट द सेम वैल्यू ऑफ के, दैट इज के इक्वल टू जीरो. सो दिस इज द काज वाई वी कॉल गैलियम आर्सेनाइड एज ए डायरेक्ट बैंड गैप सेमीकंडक्टर. हियर इट इज इंपॉर्टेंट, इट इज इंपॉर्टेंट टू नोट दैट इलेक्ट्रॉन्स इन कंडक्शन बैंड टेंड टू कॉन्सेंट्रेट एट द मिनिमम कंडक्शन बैंड एनर्जी. Which is at k equal to 0. On the other hand, holes in the valence band tend to concentrate at the uppermost valence band energy. In this EK diagram, here we can see the electrons try to concentrate in the minimum energy of the conduction band and holes try to concentrate or try to accumulate in the uppermost energy level of the valence band. And for this reason, we can also think holes as air bubbles in water, and we know that air bubbles always try to go on the top surface of the water. Since holes are trying to concentrate or accumulate in the uppermost energy levels in valence band, we can think holes as air bubbles. here minimum of the conduction band and maximum of the valence band occurs at the same K value. Therefore, gallium arsenide is said to be a direct band gap semiconductor. And in direct band gap semiconductor, transition of electrons between the two allowed bands can take place with no change in crystal momentum. So meaning is that in direct band gap semiconductor, when electrons try to get jump from valence band to conduction band or conduction band to valence band, there is no change in crystal momentum because here both of valence band maximum and conduction band minimum occur at k equal to 0. So there is no change in the crystal momentum for this direct band gap semiconductor. And this direct nature of transition has significant effect of the optical properties of the materials. So this direct nature of transitions has a significant effect in the optical properties of the materials. Therefore, direct band gap materials or semiconductors are ideally suited for use in semiconductor lasers and other optical devices. These direct band gap semiconductors or materials are very useful in optical devices. Now, let's see an example of indirect band gap here. I'm taking an example of silicon. Similarly, for silicon also, because silicon also has zinc blend structure or diamond like structure, here again we are taking two axes. For plus K, we are using a direction 100, and in minus K axis, we are taking 111 direction. And this scale on E, this is 3, 2, 1, 0, and here it's 4 electron volt, minus 1, minus 2, and in this scale, it's energy. Electron volt, and I'm sure that this scale is also not here. On this scale, this is energy in electron volt. So the band gap for gallium arsenide is 1.42 electron volt, and now I am talking about band gap in silicon. Here in this figure we can see the maximum in the valence band occurs at K equal to 0 as we saw in case of direct band gap semiconductor. Whereas the minimum in the conduction band occurs not at k equal to 0 but along the one zero zero direction. In this figure we can clearly see that maximum of the valence band occurs at k equal to 0 point, but minimum of the conduction band occurs along the 100 direction. And here, let me write it. The difference between the minimum of the conduction band and maximum valence band or maximum in the valence band energy is still defined as the band gap. Band gap energy easy. So although the minimum of the conduction band and maximum of the valence band are not occur at the same value of k, but still we are using this difference as band gap or band gap energy. Here maximum of valence band and minimum of conduction band do not occur at the same k value therefore silicon is said to be an indirect band gap semiconductor. When an electron makes a transition between valence band and conduction band, वी मस्ट कंसीडर द लॉ ऑफ कंजर्वेशन ऑफ मोमेंटम. सिंस द वैलेंस मैक्सिमम ऑफ द वैलेंस बैंड एंड मिनिमम ऑफ द कंडक्शन बैंड डू नॉट अकर एट द सेम K value, so when an electron tries to jump from conduction band to valence band or valence band to conduction band, there should be followed the law of conservation of momentum. So we have to consider this phenomena for making a transition between these bands. Therefore, a transition in an indirect band gap materials must necessarily include an interaction with the crystal so that crystal momentum is conserved. So, to make law of conservation of momentum valid in this transition, we have to consider the phonon, or we have to include the interaction between electron and crystal so that phonon can play a role in these interactions. Another example of indirect band gap semiconductor is germanium. Germanium is also an indirect band gap material or semiconductor, but one important point is very important for germanium. Germanium has a significant significantly higher hole mobility as compared to silicon. Some compound semiconductors लाइक गैलियम फास्फोरस एंड एल्यूमिनियम इज ऑल्सो हैव इनडायरेक्ट बैंड गैप्स. So this is for direct and indirect band gaps, and I'm leaving you with these important questions. That is, normally we draw EK diagram like this. This is for hole, and so this is for electrons, and this is for holes. This is a zero. So here E, and in this direction K. So here, but in normally we use conduction band and valence band in this way, but actually EK diagram looks like this. So what is difference between this and this? And another important question is that here, if I am say it's on y axis and this is on x axis, on y axis we are plotting energy E, and on x axis we are plotting K, that is momentum. But here, what is on this axis and what is on this axis? Does this axis is important or not? So you can think about this. What we can understand here, in this direction is must be E, but what is on this scale or in this axis? It is very important question to think. So please think about this point, and in offline class I will also discuss about these things. So first you have to think about these things. So in next lecture we will see the effective mass of electrons and holes.